Hi, everybody. Welcome back for part three in my three-part series about trauma.
Let's talk about trauma.
Baby, let's talk about you and me. Let's talk about all the good things and the bad things that may be. Let's talk about
trauma.
So, I said in my previous episodes that this was going to be a three-part series, and it will. Today we'll wrap up what I started in that video, and then what I followed it with in that video. So trauma resolution is complicated, and it occurred to me as I was finishing up last week's video and it had gone live that I wasn't perfectly content with what I had produced last week. I feel like there's a couple of details that I glossed that I actually want to go into more detail on today. So I want to talk a little bit more about specifically how do I recognize if I have unresolved trauma in my body or if the people I'm around do. And also some of the ways that it shows up. And then also I realized that in order to teach people how to resolve trauma, which is actually kind of the goal here, is to give you tools that you can use in order to start chipping away at and peeling down some of the layers of trauma in your system, that I actually have a little more context to create and some background to lay down in order to get to the point that you can start safely addressing your own stuff. So look forward in the near future to some videos that are specifically instructional on doing trauma resolution work. That's not this video, though, because we're not quite there with the whole story yet. Brought to you by Freeze. So how does trauma actually happen? I've covered this a little bit in my first video, and so I want to just expand on it because I think it's important to understand the process at work so that you can do something about it. So we'll talk about fight-flight first. You've, for sure, if you've watched any of my other videos, you've heard about the fight-flight response, and you know that fight or flight are the two basic modes that you get into when you need to survive. You're either going to run from a threat, flight, or you're going to attack a danger, fight. Okay. There is, of course, that third response, the freeze response. And the freeze response is, in some senses, the next gear up from fight and flight. When an organism identifies that neither fighting nor running will accomplish survival, right? You're being chased by a predator much faster than you, much stronger than you. Well, you're not going to be able to fight it off. You're not going to be able to run from it. So what can you do? Play possum. When opossums get overwhelmed, when they get frightened or startled, they go straight to catatonia, and they just fall down, and they play dead. And this actually seems to be associated with improved survival for that individual, because a predator that sees an animal drop dead that it did not kill is more likely to go, there might be something wrong here, let me go catch something fresh and alive. As humans, we're more likely to hit the fight-flight first, right? But every one of us can get overwhelmed. You remember in the first video, I said that trauma is essentially what happens when your nervous system gets overwhelmed? Let's be specific. It's what happens when your nervous system, already on the upswoop from rest and digest up towards fight or flight, gets overwhelmed, or you determine that there's no way that fight or flight can help, and so you freeze. And under a normal course of events, after you freeze, you unfreeze, and animals will often do this. If you can provoke an animal, don't. But if you can provoke an animal into a fight or flight response and then into the freeze response, it'll stay frozen for a minute or two. And then when it unfreezes, it will either try to scratch your eyes out and get away or just try to get away. But going right back into the fight or flight response after the freeze response is the next step. Humans don't always do that. Sometimes we can get knocked into a freeze response and fail to complete the fight or flight response. So on your screen right now is a little graph. It just shows arousal over time. By arousal, I obviously we're not talking about sexual arousal, we're talking about nervous system excitement. In response to a threat, a danger, or an injury, the nervous system will start to gear up. Adrenaline happens. Muscles brace. The digestive system gets turned down. The frontal brain, the part that's really designed for guessing people's motivations and predicting the future, that gets turned down. And we start to gear up muscles to run and to fight. If we flip into freeze, sometimes we'll flip back into the fight-flight response and complete it. And there's that whole arc. But sometimes we'll get overwhelmed, we'll get frozen, and when we get unfrozen, we don't go back into the fight or flight come down. Instead, we kind of stay elevated. It's like we're being chased by an invisible tiger. I'll relax when I see the invisible tiger leave. Oops. So now you're seeing on your screen a chart where right at that red star, that's where we flipped into the freeze response and failed to get back onto the track, the fight-flight resolution track. That's what trauma is. Trauma is you got flipped into the freeze response and you never completed the fight-or-flight response. So now it might make sense why people who are in trauma have a hard time with aggressive behavior. Aggressive behavior is part of that fight response. Your body's kind of responding to your own arousal, your own defense mechanisms as though they're dangerous. You get stuck. And so this can go on for years and years. That's what that red line is meant to represent on that graph. It can go on for years and years and years of an inability to complete the fight or flight response. How do I know if I have trauma? So there's some things that happen when we get traumatized. And I talked a little bit about this last time. In fact, I talked pretty extensively about this last time. But I wanted to give you some more real world examples about how to think about what you're seeing in yourself or in others and connect that to a trauma response. So a couple of things to be on the lookout for trauma. Physically, you can see things like muscle bracing. The muscles will tighten as we start to get ready to go into fight or flight in order to squeeze blood out of the digestive system, where during fight or flight, it's not really necessary, press that blood into the arms and legs, ready to run and fight. But that bracing is also bracing for potential impact. Muscle bracing, muscle tension that you just can't dissipate, that, you know, no matter how many times you massage it out, no matter how much you try to breathe it down, there's still some of it that just holds on, ready, bracing for impact. So muscle bracing is a really good indicator that there may be some trauma active. And this one's really easy to see once you notice it, and it's forward head position, by which I mean the head, the ear, is hanging out not over the shoulder, but in front. And this forward head position is part of the bracing process and the protecting process. As the fight or flight systems start to activate, you guard your throat and your neck by rolling your shoulders up and forward and crunching your head forward. Protected. If you see people walking around in the world with their heads way out in front of their bodies like this, there is a really good chance that that is a trauma response that you're seeing, that they're just stuck in a pattern of trying to defend themselves from a threat that they can't quite identify anymore. You'll sometimes get a new pain. This happens all the time in my practice. People will walk in and say, yeah, I hurt my back. How did you hurt your back? I picked up a piece of paper off the floor. Has this ever happened before? No. Have you ever had any back pain before? No. Okay. Well, so the injury didn't come from picking up a piece of paper, right? The injury came from you were teetering on the brink of injury due to aberrant and weird muscle tension that was causing harm, and you picked up a piece of paper, and that's when you teetered off the brink. The terminology we use in healthcare is innocuous mechanism of injury. That means the mechanism of injury wasn't sufficient to cause the level of injury. And so what's happening? And what's happening is that you were right there on the edge of it anyway, due to probably chronic muscle bracing. And some postural distortions that can come from chronic trauma. So that pain that came without a real injury may well be a good indicator that there's a trauma response happening, and that just flipped you over the edge. Weird ones, an increase in ticklishness, or an increase in your startle response. Ticklishness is a sort of a guard reflex and is related to the startle response. But if you used to not be ticklish and find yourself now ticklish, it's a really good indicator that your body hasn't resolved itself back down to its baseline state. There's also some emotional and cognitive things that you might notice happening. Difficulty with anger is a really common trauma response. It may not be what you think, though. So for sure, people with trauma will sometimes present as being surprisingly easy to anger. A hair trigger temper can absolutely be the result of chronic trauma responses that don't ever get resolved. But it can also be a complete lack of anger. I never get angry. I've never gotten angry. It's been years since I've been angry. Oops. So it can be way too much anger that's disproportionate to the current situation. And somebody might say, I just got really triggered. I was thinking it ended up putting me in my abuse stuff or this horrible thing that happened to me or, you know, all that can absolutely happen. But it can also really commonly go the other way, that anger is inaccessible. You just, I can't be aggressive. That's not a thing. Some cognitive differences can also be things like telling the difference between there is a risk to this course of action and this course of action is dangerous. When we're in our baseline state, the rest, digest, restore, recover kind of state, the difference between, well, yeah, there is a non-zero risk to crossing the street and crossing the street is dangerous is actually kind of clear. You know, like, yeah, there's a risk. You could get hit by a car. How likely is that? And our ability to tell how likely the risk is to actualize and to become harmful, we're much more able to do that math at the baseline state. And when we're in that traumatized state, when we're in that heightened fight, flight, freeze state, it's much harder to tell the difference between, yeah, there's some risk and wow, there's a lot of risk and danger. So if your ability to do that, or that's really, I would have a hard, how would I know that I'm doing that? I don't know that I would be able to see that very clearly about myself. But if you're noticing that in loved ones, that is probably a trauma response. And then there's some behavioral relational things that can happen with trauma responses too. A difficulty with boundaries, having a hard time saying no, but also having a hard time saying yes. You ever met a people pleaser? There's a fourth F that's been recently introduced and proposed, the fawning response as a trauma response. There it is. People who can't say no, who are people pleasers and who are trying to go out of their way to make sure that everyone's needs are met, regardless of their capacity or their needs, that's probably a trauma response. But also people who can't say yes. Hey, I'm really interested in going on a date with you. Oh, okay, do you want to meet up on Thursday? Oh, I don't know. A difficulty taking yes for an answer can also be a thing. Difficulty with boundaries in general, with saying yes, with saying no, with hearing yes, with hearing no. Nobody really likes to hear no, but there's a difference between, oh, I'm disappointed, and that's intolerable. You can also therefore see people who have had a lot of trauma will tend to use manipulation tactics instead of direct requests in order to get their needs met because they can't say or hear yes or no, but they can kind of force the situation to coerce an action. I'm not trying to be a manipulation and abuse apologist by any means. There's no background of trauma that excuses abusing people. But it can put it into context, and it does explain some of it. Okay, so those are some of the things you might see among your people or in yourself that would be really clear indicators that there's some trauma active and at work. So, what do we do about it? In upcoming episodes, we're going to talk about how to create a space that's safe to do trauma resolution work, how to foster relationships and community around doing trauma resolution, which, given the past year, may be useful shortly. Then we're going to start going into some techniques about how to address the traumatized, freaked out animal part of you and bring it safely into and out of the freeze response, into and out of the fight or flight response, so that your own defense mechanisms don't become part of the problem. I hope this was helpful. I really hope that you find some value in this. We're going to be digging deep into this over the next several weeks. I may do a couple of sort of lighter weight fun ones along the way, because this is a heavy topic and this is a big topic. Do stay tuned. Please like, comment, subscribe. If you have any questions about trauma or its effects on the body, or if you think I've said something wrong, go ahead. Put it in the comments. I will respond to anything you put there so long as it is respectful. And if you could please share this, share especially the first video in this series, because I cover a lot of ground there and this will make more sense there. So please do share so that more people know what to do with their trauma, because we are almost all of us right now carrying around more than we should be. Again, I hope this was helpful. I hope you have a great day and thanks for staying tuned. Take care. No. Let's
talk about trauma. Baby, let's talk about trauma. Let's talk about trauma. Let's talk about trauma. Let's talk about trauma.